Hi, welcome to our Friday night Bible study. We're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 15 tonight, an amazing part of the Bible. And so as we have been studying the Bible, as we've been in the midst of a pandemic, and another thing that really, as I was studying this week, the thing that I thought that was interesting is that we are in an election year, 2020. And it's interesting that, you know, this chapter, it has something to do with kind of politics, and so I want to share that with you tonight. But we'll get into the chapter tonight. But before we get started, let's go to the Lord in prayer. So, Father God, we thank you, Lord, for your word tonight, Lord. We ask that you would speak mightily into our hearts, Father. Lord, the world outside, Lord, sees things very different, Lord. Lord, we ask, Lord, that you would give us eyes to see things through your eyes tonight, Lord. That we would see your word for us tonight, Lord. That you would guide us and continue to lead us in your ways, Father. And that is our desire tonight, that you would do all those things. And we pray it tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 So we'd like to, last week we didn't have the study 2 weeks ago, and so I'd like to cover chapter 14. I love recapping the chapter before it. It gives everybody an opportunity to kind of catch up and see where we're at, and so it's a good time to do that tonight. And so as we were in chapter 14, we remember that, really briefly, we remember that there was a dispute amongst David's family. And we remember that David, as he was in chapter 11 and 12, and the sin came about that we're so familiar with, that David committed adultery and David had actually committed murder. I mean, we remember those things that went on. And so we remember there was a part of the Bible that told David that through his line now would come the consequences of his sin. They would come. And so as we've been, after we've got through chapters 11 and 12, we remember that that David now is moving forward. And we remember that his that there was a situation with Tamar, which is David's daughter. And so she is actually, there was a half-brother of his. And we're going to meet Absalom. We've been dealing with Absalom. And Absalom had a sister. Her name was Tamar. And we remember that Amnon, the brother, and actually the half-brother, had actually had relations and actually had raped his own half-sister. And so as the story went along, we remember that Absalom was the one that actually had committed a murder. He had actually killed his half-brother. And the reason why he did it, because his father David did nothing to Amnon after he had raped his sister. And so we see that as the chapter 14, they remember that Absalom was actually went to Geshur, and he was on the run, and he was in hiding from his father. And so in chapter 14, Joab actually put this lady up to going to meet the king. Remember, the king would go and he would actually hear. He was kind of like the guy that would hear the supreme judge of the land at that particular time, and he would hear the cases. And so Joab, David's commander, put this lady up to come to him and tell him that there was, and so she came with this story that actually the Bible says that Joab put the words in her mouth. And so she came and told David, without him realizing it, this story, that she was a widow. And she said that there was her two sons had gotten into a dispute, and that one of them had killed the other one, and now the family wanted to kill the other brother that had murdered him. And so she had come to him for judgment and said, what should I do in this particular situation? And we remember early on that David said, hey, go ahead and go to your house. Let me give it some thought. But this woman kept pressuring David, because Joab had already put the words in her mouth and kept pressuring her, until finally we saw that King David made a judgment, and he said, I will make sure that nobody will touch your son's head. And through that, the lady came to the realization that says, well, why won't you bring your banished one home? she what she was doing is she was talking about Absalom, that he was banished from the land. And so she said, well, why don't you bring your banished one home? And so King David came to the realization that he came to understand that somebody had put this woman up to this story. And so it's exactly what happened there in chapter 14. And actually, David actually asked this woman, can I ask you a question? Did Joab put you up to this? And she admitted that Joab had put her up to it. And so you see the King David, he called Joab his general and said, you want Absalom to come back to the land from being where he was banished? And he said, yes, King, this is what I want. And we remember that as we were in chapter 14, that Joab had actually an ulterior motive for doing this. And his ulterior motive was that if the King David, if something was to happen to him, there was no prince to take over the throne. And so what it was Joab was actually thinking about himself. He was thinking, hey, if something was to happen to King David and there's nobody to be the prince because he's banished, and then if somebody else comes in and takes over, where does that leave me? And so, see, he was thinking of himself. And this is the reason why he put this lady up to it. And so we remember there, kind of close to the end of chapter 14, this woman, she told him the story. And so David said, go ahead and call Absalom back from where he was banished. And so Joab was so excited. He went and he found Absalom, and he asked him to come back to Jerusalem. And as he was coming back to Jerusalem, David sent word and said to him, please allow him to come back, but do not allow him to see my presence or to see my face. I don't want to see him. And we see that David, a man who had been forgiven of so many things, that you see that he is withholding forgiveness from his own son. He is withholding forgiveness. And so we see that Absalom was 3 years in Geshur. He's going to spend 2 years in Jerusalem there, but he's not going to see the king. So 5 years he goes without seeing his father. And at the end of chapter 14 there, we remember that he finally, Absalom says, I cannot go any longer here in isolation, and I need to see my father. And so he says, sends for Joab, I want to speak with him. And remember, Joab, he had already gotten everything that he wanted. So what did Joab do? Joab ignored his, you know, back then they didn't have text messages, but he ignored his messages that they came. And as he was ignoring them, finally, Absalom said, well, there's no other way for me to get his attention. And he says, but his field is right outside my father's field. And so what does he do? He starts the field on fire. And remember that Joab comes out and says, why did you start my field on fire? He said, I've been trying to get your attention, trying to get you to go to the king. And as he got his attention, he told him, hey, I want you to go to the king. And I wanted to tell the king that I need to come and see my father. And we see that Joab actually did in chapter 14 at the end. He finally went and told him. And remember what King David said. He actually said, bring him. And at the end of the chapter there, he actually kissed his own son as a sign of forgiveness. But what we're going to see tonight as we open up chapter 15, we're going to see it was a little too late. You see, we're going to see that Absalom was actually harboring bitterness in his heart for his father, for all these things that his father was doing to him. And we can learn something for this, because before we get into the study tonight, that as when we harbor bitterness in our heart towards people that have done things to us, and it's not like anybody's looking at this particular story and say, you know, Absalom probably did have a right to be upset with his father, but he needed to give his father forgiveness. He needed to forgive his father, because reality is that bitterness will eat us alive. It'll eat us up. And so we're going to pick up chapter 15 here. We're going to pick it up in verse 1. And so it says, after this happened, that Absalom provided himself with chariots and horses and 50 men to run before him. You see that right after that, the king was sent, and the king sent for him, and he actually kissed his own son. You see that it was a little too late, because right after this is when actually that Absalom already had a plan, or his heart was already filled with this bitterness, and he's going to try to figure out a way. He's going to start self-promoting himself here, and he's going to start, you know, self-promoting him like a politician. He's going to come and start self-promoting himself, and we're going to see that here. And it says here that he had chariots and horses and 50 men run before him. And the reason these 50 men, remember that back in those days, as chariots and horses were coming, you would have an entourage of people that were running before them, and they would be saying, here comes the prince, the prince of the son of King David. And this is what they were doing. And so this was an entourage that was running out before the prince of Israel at this time. And so this is what he's doing. He's trying to self-promote himself at this particular time. And so here in verse 2, it says, "Now Absalom would rise early and stand beside the way to the gate. So it was whenever anyone who had a lawsuit came to the king for a decision that Absalom would call to him and say, 'What city are you from?' And he would say, 'Your servant is from such and such a tribe of Israel.'" We see that Absalom here is a plan. He's putting into play the plan to undermine what his father had done. And this is, you know, this bitterness that he's had in his heart, right away he starts to think, "I need to put my plan into order. I need to figure out a way to put my plan in." And it's interesting here, it says that he came to the gate very early. And so normally I'm sure that there was an hour that normal people would come to the gate so the king could hear their story. But what Absalom would do is he would go out before that time and he would interact with the people. And so this was a way of him trying to undermine his father and trying to gain the favor with the people. And this is what he would do, go about, and he would try to gather their thoughts, and so that way that he could believe, and so he would believe that he cared for them, right? And this is what he's doing. He's going out to the people and he wants them to say, "Hey, I care for you. You know, there's nobody here, but I care for you." But I saw something in this, and this is oftentimes what Satan does with each and every one of us. That oftentimes when we have tough things that are going on in our lives, the enemy comes and he whispers in our ear and he says, "Aren't you a believer? Don't you believe in Christ? And God doesn't seem to have time for you right now. He's not hearing your prayers," right? And this is what the enemy does. And we're going to see some parallels with Absalom and Satan here at the end. And I think that they're very, very close to each other. We're going to see that. But those are one of the things that we saw here in chapter 2, that those connections that we see, that's the same way that the enemy treats us. But here in verse 3, it says, "Then Absalom would say to him, 'Look, your case is good and right, but there is no deputy of the king to hear you.'" And so once again, Absalom, remember, he didn't say anything negative towards his father. It's not like he said, "Hey, you know, my dad's not listening to you." He didn't say any negative, but once again, he's implying like they are not taking care of you. There's nobody here to hear your story. There is nobody. And once again, it's almost like he's telling the people, "My father David, he's too busy for you. He's too busy to hear your story." And once again, we see the same thing that happens with Satan. He says, "Is God too busy to listen to your prayers? Is God too busy?" But we all know that God is never too busy, that God is always hears our prayers. And these are the things that this is going on in David's family here. So in verse 4, it says, "Moreover, Absalom would say, 'Oh, that I were made judge in the land, and everyone who has any suit or case or cause would come to me, then I could give him justice.'" And we see that this is exactly what happens in the workplace, right? Isn't this what happens in the workplace? And oftentimes it happens in the church, that there is somebody that's in charge, right? And there's a lot of people that go on behind his back and they say, "Oh, I could do a lot better job than this guy. This guy doesn't know what he's doing," right? And this is oftentimes that it happens in the church, that there is somebody that is in the church, and they are the pastor of the church, and they're the head pastor. And there, oftentimes there is people that are under shepherds, that are people that are under this particular pastor, and they, rather than using their gifts that God gave them, they use it to tell the pastor, to not even speak to the pastor, but they speak to others of the pastor that he's not doing a good job, and he's doing other things that he shouldn't be doing. And so we need to know that oftentimes that we, as if we've been gifted to do something for a church, and if God has gifted us and he has put it on our hearts to go, that we are to elevate that pastor. And even if we don't agree with some of the things or how he goes about some of the things, we are called to come alongside and to be, we are part of the body of Christ. We are to come alongside him and help the body grow. And this is what actually needs. You know, in a church, oftentimes, this is always so familiar to us that it's a lot of the young people say, we don't like going to that church because there's a lot of old people that go to that church, right? And what's interesting is God is so amazing that we need the enthusiasm, us older people, we need the enthusiasm of the young people, but also the young people need the wisdom of the elder people, and they can see the things that are going on in life, and they can see things that they normally couldn't see. But we need to know if God has called us for whatever position that he's called us to, whether it's in the church or in the workplace, if it is God's will, he will elevate us to that position. And we remember the story of Joseph. It's his brothers sold him into slavery. We remember that no matter what he did, if he went to Potiphar's house, he was actually put in jail. And we remember that later on he became the second in charge, right? The second in command to Pharaoh. And that if we need to know that if it is God, God will elevate us to whatever position it is that he has called for us. And this is not self-promotion. God will lift us up. We don't need to step on anybody else to get to the top. We need to wait on the Lord and pray to the Lord, and the Lord will open doors for us. And in verse 5 it says, and so it was whenever anyone came near to bow down to him, that he would put out his hand and take him and kiss him. And so in the Middle East, this is unfamiliar to us, but remember in the Middle East that men, they would kiss each other on the cheek, right? They would kiss each other. And this is what reminded me that this must be something familiar. Remember that politicians, when they go out and they try to get you and you actually meet a politician, remember a long time ago, I don't know if they still do it, but they used to go out and they used to kiss the heads of kids, right, to gain favor with their parents. They would go along kissing children. And you see that here, that this is exactly what Absalom's doing. He's becoming a politician, right? He's becoming a politician. He's trying to win the people over to his side. And this is the reason why I say that God's word is so relevant to what's going on today. And I'm not going to sit here and preach to you about this coming election. But what I will talk to you about, or I wish you would talk about, that any candidate, no matter what side of the fence you sit on, please, I ask that you would go and do your own investigating about your particular candidate. Rather than listening to the things that are written on the television or things, we need to know actual factual things about these particular candidates before we voice our opinion. Because I've heard so many people lately that they speak about particular candidates, but not really knowing the true actual story that's going on in that particular person's life or what's going on with them. And so we need to remember those things. And so in verse 6, it says, in this manner, Absalom acted toward all of Israel who came to the king for judgment. So Absalom stole the hearts of the men of Israel. And so we see right away that this is something that Absalom, the way he acted, you see, Absalom was putting on an act. You know, he was putting on an act. He was trying to make himself out to be a Mr. Nice Guy. I really do care for you. But he, as it says here, he stole the hearts of the people. He didn't win the hearts of them. And oftentimes when somebody steals the heart of somebody, that they give them false words, right? They give them words and they make promises. And we need to know that as people make promises, there's only one. Jesus is the only one that can fulfill a true promise, right? The world can never fulfill. There's oftentimes politicians come and they promise us many things, but in reality, yes, they cannot promise us anything. But we need to know, as we spend time in God's word, God's promises are true. And those are the things that we need to trust in. We need to know the promises of God. It's so important that we do those things. But one of the things that really drew my attention to is we see that Absalom is self-promoting himself. He is self-promoting, trying to lift himself up. Not like David. Remember David, when he was a young man, he was anointed to be the king of Israel. And I've been reading this small book, and it's a very good book. It's called A Tale of Three Kings by Gene Edwards. And it's a story of brokenness. And we see that David, as he was on the run from Saul, and oftentimes this is the reason why I use this, is because it's oftentimes what happens in our lives. And remember that King David, and when he was very young, he was anointed to be the king of Israel. But we remember that Saul, all Saul did, which was the king at that particular time, that all he did in his life is he made David's heart, his life miserable. He went around and he chased him. He threw spears at him. He was on the run, living in the wilderness. He didn't have a place to call home, and he was on the run. But in that brokenness that David was experiencing, the Lord was preparing him for what was to come in life. And these are the things that we need to know, that God is preparing each and every one of us for the things that are to come. And so oftentimes when we have bad things happen in our life, we need to know that God is going to use those things to further us down the line. We might not need it right then, but it'll be some wisdom that we can use down the road. It's so important for us to know that God never leaves us. And he never forsakes us, that he's with us always. And so verse 7, it says, "Now it came to pass after 40 years that Absalom said to the king, 'Please let me go to Hebron and pay the vow which I made to the Lord.'" So as we see that something here, we remember that that Hebron is where David was anointed to be king of Judah. And this comes from 2 Samuel 2:4. That this is where exactly the place where he was. And at Hebron, we remember that it was the capital of Israel at one time. When David, it was the capital. And remember that David actually moved it. When he moved the Ark of the Covenant, he moved it to Jerusalem, which is the capital of Israel today. And so it's just so interesting there. And I would draw your attention to where it says here 40 years. The Septuagint manuscripts and Josephus, Flavius Josephus, it reads that this is only 4 years. And you might ask, like, what's such a big discrepancy from 4 to 40? Some commentators believe that maybe possibly the reason why it got kind of mumbled up here, it got kind of the either 4 or 40, because some people believe that that this is a time that King David has already been ruling for 40 years. And this is the reason why 40 shows up here. And others believe that maybe Absalom could be close to the age of 40. We know that King David is approximately 60 years old at this time. And so they think this is where this 40 comes from. But we know that, you know, 40 years, it could not be, because of the timeline wouldn't be correct. And so the manuscripts, the Septuagint, says that it's 4 years, and Flavius Josephus says 4 years. And so we see something there in that, and so the timeline. And so in verse 8 it says, "For your servant took a vow while I dwelt at Geshur in Syria, saying, 'If the Lord indeed brings me back to Jerusalem, then I will serve the Lord.'" We see that this vow that he made, what he is saying, that he made a vow to the Lord, that if the Lord would bring him back. Remember, he was banished, and so he says, "Hey, Lord, if you bring me back, if you allow me to come back, then I will make a vow right to you." And so this is exactly what he's telling his father. "If you will let me go back, then I will. I want to go and I want to make this vow and serve this vow." And this is exactly what he's saying. But what's interesting about this vow, that Absalom actually has other intentions to go. As he's going to go leave and he's going to go to Hebron, he has other intentions. And we need to remember, and don't forget about, that Absalom has this bitterness in his heart, right? This is all part of his plan. He has this bitterness in his heart that he's hanging on to, right? And so in verse 9 it says, "And the king said to him, 'Go in peace.' So he arose and went to Hebron." And so we see that King David, when he heard that he was going to go fulfill a vow, that the King David says to him, "Go in peace." And this is one of the last words that King David would say to his son Absalom. And it's just interesting that he says to him, "Go in peace," that he's actually telling him to go and fulfill this vow. And King David doesn't have any idea what his son is about to do. And we're going to see that here. But we see that these are the last words that he says to his son. And oftentimes it makes me think about things about life. Oftentimes with this pandemic and all the things that are going on in the world, we remember that we need to cherish our loved ones in every moment that we see them. I'm brought to so much joy in my heart when I see people come to the Bible study, because oftentimes we really don't know when the last time we're going to see each other. And I always want them to know that we always want our loved ones to know that we love them. And most of all, the thing that brings joy to my heart, that they are seeking the Word of God, that we know that God's promises is true, that no matter what happens here on earth, that one day we will all be together in eternity. That is the thing that brings me the most joy, when they come to know those things. So in verse 10, it says, then Absalom sent spies throughout all the tribes of Israel, saying, as soon as you hear the sound of the trumpet, then you will say, Absalom reigns in Hebron. You see, as Absalom had stole the hearts of the people, he convinced the people that now he is going to go to Hebron and he is going to announce that he's going to be the new king, his son, right? He is trying to dethrone his father. And this is the plan, the bitterness of his heart. This is what he has in his heart. And this is his plan. He's putting it into play and he wants to dethrone his father, King David, right? The mighty King David who took on Goliath. His son has decided that he is going to take on his father. And so verse 11, it says, and with Absalom went 200 men invited from Jerusalem, and they went along innocently and did not know anything. You see, the 200 men that he brought from Jerusalem, they were soldiers and they're going along with Absalom. But the thing that they did not know, they were innocent. They didn't know anything that Absalom had in his plans. But the thing that's interesting about this is that the people looking at all these 200 soldiers that are with Absalom, they will think that, oh, they are with Absalom. But these soldiers, these 200 soldiers knew nothing about what was going on. They had no idea what was going on. And in verse 12, it says, then Absalom sent for Ahithophel, the Gihonite, David's counselor from his city, from Gilo, while he offered sacrifices, and the conspiracy grew strong, for the people with Absalom continually increased in number. We see that Ahithophel is David's number one counselor. This is his counselor that gave him all. It says in 2 Samuel 16:23 that Ahithophel's advice, it says the advice of Ahithophel was as if one had inquired of the oracles of God. So this, his counselor, they said that his counseling was like if it came from the oracles of God. And so this is David's number one guy. And you see that the one that approaches him is Absalom, right? Absalom approaches him and says, hey, do you want to come over to my side? Ahithophel. And this is David's number one guy. This is David's number one guy. And we see that Ahithophel wants to, you know, he asked him if he wants to come over. And we're going to see that Ahithophel is going to go over with Absalom. And so the first thing we draw our attention to is that who is Ahithophel? And if we remember in scripture here that he was mentioned way early on in chapters 11 and 12. But Ahithophel is, interestingly enough, this is Bathsheba's grandfather, right? This is who Ahithophel is. His great counselor is Bathsheba's grandfather. And they believe the Bible, many commentators believe that the bitterness that he held in his heart is that they remember what David had done to his granddaughter Bathsheba, that he had committed adultery, right? And he had actually murdered her husband. And so you see that he had been harboring this bitterness. And so when you get this bitterness, with Absalom's bitterness in his heart, and we're going to see what that's going to lead both of them to do. Really quick, I'd like to mention, in this particular time in David's life, David is going through a lot of hardships at this particular time, and he's actually, his own son is turning against him. And oftentimes when things are not going correctly in life, or things are actually hard for us, that we should seek God. And David did know, he did exactly that. You see, at this particular time, David, in this when Absalom's taking over, and we're going to see King David is going to leave Jerusalem, it's going to leave Jerusalem. And we're going to see that he actually wrote, at this particular time, he wrote Psalm 3, he wrote Psalm 39, he wrote Psalm 41, Psalm 55, Psalm 61, and Psalm 63. And we see that David, King David, was seeking the word of God. He was seeking God's, he needed to feel God's closeness because he wasn't sure what God was doing in his life. And so that's where we need to be. We need to be seeking God all the time, but especially when things are not going correctly in our lives. And so in verse 13, it says, now a messenger came to David saying, the hearts of the men of Israel are with Absalom. And so we see that King David now, he knows that Absalom had stole the hearts of the people, and now they are with Absalom. And so he's starting to get the impression that people, that Absalom is now having a following. And in verse 14, it says, so David said to all of his servants who were with him at Jerusalem, "Arise and let us flee, or we shall not escape from Absalom. Make haste to depart, lest he overtake us suddenly and bring disaster upon us, and strike the city with the edge of the sword." And we see that King David, he gathers his servants, and the first thing he says is, "Let's leave Jerusalem." He wants to flee. The mighty King David, who was a man after God's own heart, but he was a mighty man of war. He was a man of war. But we see something here that we see that David, he has a love for his son. He has a love. This is a family member of his. And the reason why, one of the reasons why, is because he doesn't want to confront his son, because he knows that his son, who he is. And oftentimes I think as us fathers, we know that if our son is going to actually has the heart to commit these things that he's actually talking about here. And so what I believe that David does know his son, and this is the reason why he decides to take his servants and flee. And as he flees, he also is going to leave Jerusalem. But we see that his son Absalom, I believe that in his heart, he had every intention to come and confront David. Right, with that bitterness that he had in his heart, and now that he has his actually his chief counselor, he has him in his with him. Ahithophel is with him, and so he is gathering steam, and he is starting to figure out a way to overtake his father. And so they decide to leave. And in verse 15 it says, "And the king's servant said to the king, 'We are your servants, ready to do whatever my lord the king commands.'" And you see, the servants of David, they had been with David, and they had been with him for such a long time, but we see that the servants of David, the king, they say, "It doesn't matter, whatever happens, we are with you. We are with you, king, no matter what. We have been with you, you have been with us in good and bad. We have been with us all the time. We are here with you." And this is the heart that we need to have for Jesus Christ, that we are with you, Lord. What is your will for our lives, right? Oftentimes, I think that we look at ourselves and we say, "Hey, this is what I want to do tomorrow." But we need to look at tomorrow and say, "Lord, this is what I will to do. But if it is your will for me to do something else, change my heart and give me what you've called me to do." If there's somebody in my family, if there's somebody, a friend, if there is a loved one that needs to hear from you, Lord, put that on my heart that I can do that. And so we are supposed to be seeking the will of God, but also to be in Jesus and saying to Jesus, "We are ready, Lord, to do whatever you've called us to do." This is where we need to be as a servant of the Lord. And in verse 16, it says, "Then the king went out with all his household after him, but the king left 10 women concubines to keep the house." And we see that David, he leaves in order. And if you don't know what a concubine is a woman that a king would have, but she is not his wife. She is not his wife, right? These are kind of what we would consider today probably girlfriends, right? This is what he leaves. And he leaves 10 of them in the household. And it's going to be interesting as we push forward in the scriptures that we're going to see that this is going to fulfill a prophecy that Nathan gave him. And we're going to see that this prophecy is going to be fulfilled down the road. And it's so interesting how God's word can speak prophetically in the future. And these are the things that are going to happen. And so in verse 17, it says, "And the king went out with all the people after him and stopped at the outskirts." And so as King David is on the outskirts of the city and he's looking back, what he's doing here is he's reminiscing in his mind and he's saying, "If it is God's will for Absalom to be the king of Israel, then so be it. But if it is the will of God for me to be the king, then so be it." And so he is leaving and he is saying, "I'm going to let God decide. I'm going to let God decide that who is going to be the king." And this is interesting because there is a story. I'm not sure if how many people are familiar with it, but in Numbers 16, there is a story of a very familiar story that is very similar to this particular story. You see, there was men that came alongside Moses and his brother Aaron, right? And his one of the guy's name, that his name was Korah. It was a guy. His name was Korah. And he had two other friends. And they said, "Moses, what makes you the one in charge? What makes you the one in charge, Moses, you and Aaron?" And so Moses said to him, "You know what? I don't know. Let's let the Lord decide. Let's let the Lord decide who he wills." And so tomorrow morning, meet me here in the tabernacle and we'll let the Lord decide who he chooses. If he's going to choose you and your friends, or if he's going to choose me and Aaron. Moses speaking, right? And so the Lord, actually the next day, they say that the presence of the Lord showed up. And what had actually happened is he had spoke to Moses, and he had told Moses that there was 250 men alongside. And this is where oftentimes, this is the reason why I'm speaking about this, because oftentimes that we often feel that if they have the majority, they have the majority of the people. And this is what's happening in this story, that if they have the majority of the people. And so this guy, Korah, he had his two friends, and he had 250 followers that were following him, and Moses and Aaron were them against all these other people. And so oftentimes I think when we're outnumbered, maybe we feel like, oh, you know what, maybe it's not going to go so well here. But we need to remember that if we have God on our side, that we have way more than anybody else, no matter how many people they have behind them. And if we are seeking the will of God. But exactly these 250 men. And so the story goes that they told these 250 men to actually make incense. And so they made this little jar, a censer, they called it. And they made this little jar and they put incense in it. And these 250 men went alongside Korah and his two friends. And they said they were going to let the Lord decide who was the one that's going to be in charge. And as soon as the Lord's presence of the Lord came, the Lord spoke to Moses and said, get away from those people. Get away from them. Do not stand next to their tent. And Moses and Aaron said, hey, wait a minute. Let's not punish everybody for what one person has done, this guy Korah. And so the Lord said, tell the 250 people to move away from Korah and his two friends. And what actually Moses said, he said, if these men die of natural causes, then you'll know that they were the ones that actually, that the Lord did. But if they die before their time, then they will know that the Lord has chosen us instead of them. And Moses, as soon as he's finished speaking, the ground opened up and swallowed these three people, Korah and his two friends. And you know, as I was studying this story, I said, you know, to me in my heart, you know, I'm not, you know, like Moses's heart or Aaron's heart, but me, I would have said, hey, is there anybody else that maybe want to challenge anybody to be the one to be in charge? And we see that that's not exactly what happened. But also we see that the Lord, the 250 men that actually were with them, they actually fled because they were scared of, they had saw exactly what happened to Korah and these other two men. And the Lord had made a decision, but they say that fire was sent and these 250 men also perished. And we see that, and the story is an amazing story if you get an opportunity to read it. But this is exactly what happens, that the Lord elevates the people that he has called. And oftentimes I think in the world, we look at people and we say, wow, that person is super good looking, or that person is very talented, or that person has so many gifts that we see as, but we need to remember one thing, that God, you know, he doesn't look at people the way we look at people. He looks at their heart. He looks at their heart, right? And he will give whatever person. If we look at a person, we're saying, God, that guy, he's not very talented, but God will empower him to do whatever the will is of God. He doesn't have to be somebody that the world looks at and says, wow, that person is special. God sees us all and he knows our hearts. If we are willing, he will use us. And so here in verse 18, and it says, then all of his servants passed before him, and all the Cherethites and the Pethelites and all the Gittites, 600 men who followed him from Gath, passed before the king. And so all of these people listed here are Gentiles. We remember the 600 men that have been with David all along, the 600 mighty men. And these are all Gentile converts, right? They had been converted to know Yahweh, right? The God of Jesus, the God of Jesus Christ that we know today. And so they had been converted and they had been Gentile converters. And so we see that these people, that David had been an example of who God was. And so we see that these Gentiles, they wanted to come to know God. And so through their experience of interacting with David, they have come to know God. And these are the people that have been with David, right? We remember that they were with David in the cave, right? When Saul, he was on the run from Saul. And they remember they were the ones that were with him in the camp when he had spared Saul's life twice, right? These are the men that actually know David and have been with David through thick and thin. And we need to know that those guys are the ones that are really loyal to David. And so we're going to see how the Lord is going to use this. And so in verse 19, it says, then the king said to Attai the Gittite, why are you also going with us? Return and remain with the king, for you are a foreigner and also an exile from your own place. So this man Attai, we haven't been introduced to him. What he is, he's also another Gentile. But we see that as these Gentiles, as they're being brought along here, that this particular one, we're going to see in the next verse that he's going to say, you only came yesterday. But the reality is this man Attai has only come in a very short time. It doesn't mean that he hasn't come only yesterday. It means that he has only been with him for a short time. And so we see that he is telling him that, why are you going to remain with me? Why are you going to remain with me? You've only been here for a short time. And we're going to see that he's going to give him an out to actually go back. But what's interesting here is, I believe in this particular verse that actually David is not 100% sure that the Lord is going to bring him back. Because he tells this man Attai, why don't you return and remain with the king? And he's talking about Absalom. He's saying, why don't you go back with Absalom? And so I think that David in his heart here, he's not 100% sure that the Lord is going to bring him back. But we're going to see that the Lord is going to give him a sign here, and he's going to let him know that he's going to come back. And it says here about this man Attai in 20, it says, in fact, you came only yesterday. Should I make you wander up and down with us today? Since I go and know not where, return and take your brethren back. Mercy and truth be with you. And so we see that King David says, hey, you don't need to stay here with me. You only came, you've only been with us for a very short time. So you can go ahead and go back if you want to go back. And so this is this man Attai. He tells him, hey, you don't have to stay here with me. You can actually go back to where you came from. But I love this in verse 21. It says, but Attai answered the king and said, as the Lord lives and as my lord the king lives, surely in whatever place my lord the king shall be, whether in death or life, even there also your servant will be. And so we see that this Attai is loyal to King David here. And he says, it doesn't matter, I'm going with you. And if they're going to come and they're going to kill you and you are going to die, I will be with you. And this is interesting, because as we see this verse, this reminded me, and it should ring a familiar place in the Bible in our hearts, in the book of Ruth. We remember that Naomi and Ruth, when they were there, and remember when Naomi was telling her sister-in-laws, go back, you don't want to remain with me, go back, right? And so we know that Orpah, right, she went back. She said, oh, okay, I'm going to go back to my family. And Orpah, and this comes from Ruth chapter 1, 16 and 17. Orpah went back. And then Naomi told Ruth, you need to go back too. And she said, no, I'm not going back. She said, you know, the thing that I love so much that she said, you know what, wherever you go, I'll go. And your God will be my God. Where you die, I'm going to die. And so we see the loyalty of these things. It's so impressive, because we know that the book of Ruth, we know that in Matthew 1, that we know that she is in the genealogy, that Ruth is in genealogy, in the bloodline of Jesus Christ, right? The King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That she a Gentile, right? That she is a foreigner, right? A Moabite. These were the enemies of Israel, right? But she is in the bloodline of Jesus Christ. She is the one that is coming. So it's so important for us, like you said, though, that God saw her loyalty of her heart, right? He didn't look at her and say, oh, you're from the tribe of Moab. Oh, you're not allowed in. And I think oftentimes as us as believers, and even oftentimes unbelievers, we seem to look at sets of people and we look at them and we say, oh, they have this or they have that. God doesn't want to call those people. God loves us all. And he's calling all of us to give our hearts to him. This is what God is calling us. And we see that it's so important. This man Attai, he had a heart for the things of God. And so in verse 22, it says, so David said to Attai, go and cross over. Then Attai, the Gittite, and all his men and all the little ones were with him, crossed over. And we see that David saw the heart of Attai, and he said, go and call your family, even the little children, and bring them with us, bring them with you, right? And so Jesus, he says, he can read our hearts. Jesus can read our hearts, just like David saw the heart of this man. Jesus can read hearts. And he's the one that if we will confess our sins before him, he will give us a forgiveness. And he will remember that he sent his son to die for our sins, right? He sent his son to die for our sins. And we all know that the penalty for sin is death, right? It says very clearly in the Bible, right? Jesus came to fulfill the law, right? He came to fulfill the law. But the penalty for sin is death. But this is the part that everybody leaves out of that verse. And this comes from Romans 6:23. We all know that the penalty of sin, if we sin, the penalty for that is death. But this is so amazing. It says, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The gift of God. And so, you know, it's interesting. I was doing a study at another place. And what I love about it so much is, you know, oftentimes there's been people that said, hey, Mike, I don't know how to give my life to Christ. I don't know how to go about it. Is there some kind of a special word that I need to say to God that he's going to accept me? And what you need to know is you need to know that God sent his son to die on a cross for you. And he sent his son to die for me. And what we need to know that if we will accept his gift of grace and mercy, if we will accept it and say, Lord, yes, I accept that gift of grace and mercy that you give me so freely. And you give it to me that I will accept it. And I confess, I say the same things you say about my sins. Yes, I agree that I have sinned. And then the Bible says that all have fallen short and of the glory of God, right? We have all sinned before God, and we need to accept that. And if we will accept that and confess with our lips, right, that we will be saved. That is God's word. And so there is no special formula. I shared this the other night with a group of men that if we will, in our heart and sincerity of heart, if we will say, Lord, forgive me, I have not walked in the ways of God, he will forgive us and he will save us from our sin. God's heart, I want you to know tonight, if you get anything tonight, God's heart that we would all come to him and ask for forgiveness. This is what God is calling us to ask for forgiveness. It's not a set of rules and regulations. You know, oftentimes I've been working with some people at work, and I've actually, you know, told one of them, Jimmy is his name, and his wife, Jessie, have been there at work. And I asked Jimmy, I said, Jimmy, we know we're going to heaven, right? And he says, I hope so. And I want each and every person to know, if you will accept the gift of grace that God has sent his son, remember, it is finished. It is done already. There isn't anything that we need to do. If we will accept that, God has promised that he will take us. He has prepared a place for each and every one of us, and he will take us home to heaven with him. And that is God's promise. And so in verse 23, it says, and all the country wept with a loud voice, and all the people crossed over. And the king himself also crossed over the brook Kidron, and all the people crossed over toward the way of the wilderness. So we see David is broken here. We see that he's with a loud voice, right? He's weeping. And so we see that this is the things that David is going on. But as I spoke about earlier, Romans 8:28, and I think some of these things, they lose their luster as we know these Bible verses, but we really need to break them apart. And remember that Paul only said this one time. He said, all things work together, for good to those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose. We need to understand that even when the bad things happen, right? It says God causes everything, including bad, right? Hard, challenging, unfair things to work together for our good. That is the heart of God, because I think that oftentimes this verse is read and they often think that, oh, it's only the good things that God wants to use. No, he wants to use the challenging things, the hard things, the rough things, the things that we come to the end of ourselves, and he wants us to come to the end of ourselves, because when we come to the end of ourselves, we can only put our trust in him. And this is where God wants to have our hearts. He wants us to put our trust in him. And so we need to do those things. Really quick, the brook Kidron, it's in Jerusalem, and it's a small stream that separates Jerusalem and the Mount of Olives. And so it's going to come into play here in a little bit. In 24, it says, there was Zodok also, and all the Levites with him, bearing the Ark of the Covenant of God. And they set down the Ark of God, and Abiathar went up until all the people had finished crossing over from the city. And so we see that this Zadok and also Abiathar, these are the priests, right? And how we know that they're the priests, and we're gonna get into this, we're just gonna very clearly tell us that they're the priests. But how they know that is because they're carrying the Ark of the Covenant. Remember that David learned, as we were studying, that we learned that the Ark of the Covenant can only be carried by the priest, right? It is in the Leviticus tribe that they have to be from a Levite tribe, and they can only are the ones that are allowed to carry. And so they were carrying the Ark of the Covenant. But I believe that when David saw the Ark of the Covenant, that the Spirit of God lifted his spirits. And we're going to see that here. And we're going to see David is going to change gears here. And let's read here in verse 25. Then the king said to Zadok, carry the ark. This is what David said to him. Carry the ark of God back into the city. If I find favor in the eyes of the Lord, he will bring me back and show me both it and its dwelling place. We see that David, as he saw the Ark of the Covenant, and we know the story that as the covenant, the Ark of the Covenant was out in the wilderness, and how God had actually killed a person for because they were carrying it on a cart, and God had put the responsibility of David to bring it back to Jerusalem. As if when David saw that, he said, you know what, Lord, you've been with me through all these things. And I think that when we're going through tough times, we need to go back and think about the places that God has brought us through. And that's what renews our faith. And that's what, you know, our spirit is lifted up. And this is exactly what happens to David. And he says it very clearly here. If I find favor in the eyes of the Lord, he will bring me back. And this is what we need to know, is that God will bring us back to what we were. And he's the one that's going to do that. And so in verse 26, it says, but if he says this, I have no delight in you, here I am, let him do as it seems good to him. And so David is come to a place that says, if the Lord wills, and if he doesn't, if he has no delight in me no more, and he has done with me, then that he can do whatever seems good to him. And so this is where we need to, each one, every one of us need to come to that place too, that if God is done with us, then that is fine with us. We're willing to do whatever he wants us to do. But this is still, David knows that no matter what happens, if God decides to make his son the king, and maybe banishes him to someplace else, or maybe even if the king, the new king, was to kill him, David is ready to go because he knows the Lord. He knows the Lord. And so he knows God's promises, and he knows that he has a place for him. And so this is where we need to be, is no matter what God is wills for us, that we know that he is with us. And so in verse 27, it says, the king also said to Zadok the priest, are you not a seer? Return to the city in peace. And you and your two sons with you, Ahimaaz, your son, and Jonathan, the son of Abiathar. And so what he is telling him, he says that, are you not a seer? He's saying, aren't you a prophet? This is an old term for a prophet. And so what David is, the, being filled with the Spirit here and being revived with his faith, he is coming to the understanding. And now God is putting his heart, the Holy Spirit is working in his heart. And he's thinking, hey, aren't you a seer? You should go with Absalom. And then you can tell me, or the if the Lord gives you you know, gives you a prophecy, then you can come and you can tell me about what's happening. And so we could see that David here now through the Holy Spirit is working, and he has given him these ideas what he's going to do. And we're going to see some other amazing ones here. So in verse 28, it says, see, I will wait in the plains of the wilderness until word comes from you to inform me. Therefore, Zadok and Abiathar carried the Ark of God back to Jerusalem, and they remain there. And so we see that Abiathar, these two priests, they decide to take the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem where it belonged. And they took it back, and they say, okay, this is exactly what we're going to do. We are going to kind of be spies for King David, and we're going to go with Absalom to Jerusalem. And this is what we're going to do. We're going to go back, and we're going to be there in Jerusalem. And in verse 30, it says, so David went up by the ascent of the Mount of Olives, and wept as he went up, and he and his head covered and went barefoot, and all the people who were with him covered their heads and went up weeping as they went up. And so we see that they're weeping. We see that David here is barefoot, and we see this is all a sign of mourning and weeping. What's so interesting about this, I mentioned earlier about the Brook Kidron, and then now we see that that we're here in the Mount of Olives. This is the exact same route that Jesus Christ would take. This is the exact same route that Jesus Christ would walk. We see here that the Son of David, right, which Jesus is called, is taking this exact same route. And it's interesting to me to see that he is weeping and crying as he's going along, but this is the exact same route that Jesus Christ would come and walk down. And so in verse 31, it says, then someone told David, saying, Ahithophel is among the conspirators with Absalom. And David said, O Lord, I pray, turn the counselor of Ahithophel into foolishness. And so we know that the counsel of Ahithophel, his right-hand guy, we know that it is very powerful. But we see that as David here, as he's in, has a prayer in time of need, and this is oftentimes where our prayers come from, that he says, let there be let this counsel of Ahithophel turn into foolishness. And we're going to see that this is going to be a prayer that the Lord is going to answer. And he's going to answer it here in the very next verse. I just love it. But we see that as David was praying, and we talked a little bit about the Psalms, in Psalm 3, in this particular part, he says, arise, O Lord, save me. This is what David says to the Lord, save me. And so here in verse 32, it says, now it happened when David had come to the top of the mountain where he worshiped God, there was Hushai the Archite coming to meet him with his robe torn and the dust on his head. So we see that what David was doing when he was distraught, finding out that Ahithophel was the one that was going with his son Absalom, what the first thing that he did, and so this is what we should also do when we have problems in our life, we should worship God. We should seek God. This is what we should be doing. We should be seeking God. But the thing, like I said, though, that the Lord answered this man, Hushai, this is his second counselor, right? And this is going to, and we're going to see how the Lord is going to use this second counselor here. It's just so amazing. And so the Lord sent this man, Hushai. And so we need to know that when we are in our time of need, that God answers our prayer. And we see as David here, he answers his prayer by sending this man, Hushai, his second counselor. In verse 33, it says, David said to him, if you go on with me, then you will be a burden to me. It says, but if you return to the city and say to Absalom, I will be your servant, O king, as I was your father's servant previously, so I will now also be your servant, then you may defeat the counsel of Ahithophel for me. And so this is exactly what happens. This man, Hushai, he goes along, and we're going to see as we push forward, I'm going to give you kind of a spoiler alert, as we move forward, exactly what happens is there's time that this man, Ahithophel, gives Absalom counsel, and this counsel is probably the one that is going to defeat David. And we see that this man, Hushai, comes along, and they asked him, Absalom asked him, what do you think about the counsel that I got from Ahithophel? And Hushai says, no, I don't think that's right. I think this is what you should do. And so it's interesting. Absalom follows his counsel, and that's what leads to him being defeated. Because I see that the Lord intervened here, and the Lord said, sent this man to, and in David's prayer, that he would, that Ahithophel would turn that counsel into foolishness. And the Lord heard his prayer, and he answered it here by sending this man there with him. Are we in verse 35?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And do not have Zodak and Abathar, and do you not have Abathar or Zodak and Abathar the priest with you there? Therefore, it will be that whatever you hear from the king's house, you shall tell to Zodak and Abathar the priest. And in verse 36 it says, indeed, they have there with them their two sons, Ahimanez, Zodak's son, and Jonathan, Abathar's son. And by them you shall send me everything you hear. And so he's saying that these two priests are there and they have two sons. And they're going to come and they're going to bring me all counsel. And so like once again, we see that the priests are probably the elderly men with all the wisdom and especially godly wisdom. But they have young sons. And they say your young sons can come and bring the counsel to King David. And so the King David can find out what's going on the other side, even though he's not going to be in Jerusalem. And so in verse 37, it says, so Hushai, David's friend, went into the city, and Absalom came into Jerusalem. And so we see that David's friend went and did exactly what David had called him to do. But we see that Absalom now came to Jerusalem looking to kill his father. He's looking to defeat his own father and take over the throne. I want you to draw some parallels as I close tonight. I want to draw some parallels. I talked about this earlier about Absalom and Satan. It really spoke to me this week. And so these two things that are found so familiar, we remember that Absalom, they say that he was very good looking. right? He was very handsome. The Bible talks about that. And it talks about that in 2 Samuel 14:25. They said that not even a blemish, they could not find a blemish from head to toe. He had not a blemish on him. And this is the same thing that they say in Ezekiel 28:12 about Satan. That oftentimes I think that we think of Satan as being the guy with the pointed, the sharp, and he's got the little pitchfork. That's not who Satan is. They say that this says that the Bible says that he is perfect in beauty. This is who Satan is. He is perfect in beauty. And so we can see these two things that are very familiar with Absalom and Satan, that they are very good looking. And so another thing is that they both have a desire to be worshipped. You see, the whole thing, that the reason why that Absalom is doing this is he has a desire to be worshipped by the people. And this is the same thing that Satan does. His desire, and the reason why he was thrown out of heaven, because he wanted not the worship to go to God, he wanted the worship to go to him. And this is the same thing that Absalom is doing here. And this is one of the things that's so interesting. And the other thing that we see, that Absalom stole the hearts of the people. Right? He stole the hearts. He didn't win the hearts of the people. He stole the hearts. And this is exactly what Satan does. He steals the heart of people. Right? He steals the heart of people. He doesn't allow the people to hear the truth. Right? He doesn't allow them to hear the truth. Another thing, we know that Absalom, he is a murderer, right? He murdered his own brother Amnon, right? And it's interesting that also that the Bible points out in John 8:44 that Satan is, it says he was the murderer from the beginning. That we see that same parallel, that Satan was the murderer from the beginning. Another thing that before we get into the last one, which I feel is very powerful, as I was reading this, another thing came to me also today, that another thing that that Absalom has is that he has hatred, or he has bitterness in his heart towards the person, or before the person who created him. We see that Absalom, his father David, he's coming now and he's wanting to kill his father. And the same thing as Satan, right? He is a created being. Right? And he is fighting against the one who created him, God himself. And this is the two parallels that they have. But this is the one that really spoke to me, that Absalom, as we're going to push forward here in 2 Samuel 18:17, we're going to see Absalom, that he is going to be thrown into a pit. He is going to be thrown into a pit. And we all know that Satan will be thrown into the bottomless pit. And this is in Revelation 23. And so we know that the enemy can never be defeated against our God. And we're going to see, as we push forward in chapter 16 all the way until 18 and 20, we're going to see that this conflict between his own son here, Absalom, and David is going to go on. But we remember that all of these things, as we go back and we think about them, are all the consequences of the sin David had. And so we need to be very careful in the sin that we think about. And oftentimes, like I said, God always gives us a way out. We need to be looking for a way out when he comes along and he tries to tempt us to do things that are not correct. And so we thank you for tonight. God bless you all who are watching on the internet and all who came tonight. But let's close in prayer tonight. So Father God, we're in awe of all the things that you're doing in our lives, Father. And Lord, we've come this evening, Father, to hear from you, Lord. May you continue to be with each and every one of us, Lord. We pray that you would be with our families, Lord. We pray, Father God, that you also keep this pandemic away from us and away from our families, Father. We ask also, Lord, that you would use all the people here and all the people who tune in online, Father. We pray that you would use them to further your kingdom. That is our prayer tonight, Father, and we pray all these things, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.